stockings, there's some that they plug in and it's.
No, they're electric.
Yeah,
there's stockings that they still use, but there's also these air jackets that fit on the lower legs and on the upper legs too. And they will inflate and deflate. And that helps to keep the blood circulating. The before those were came about, the TED stockings were the mainstay, the go-to for. Okay, another thing is hypercoagulability or an increase in blood clot formation. There may be something with the patient, polycythemia, something that makes the patient have an increased tendency for blood clotting. And injury to the endothelial cells that line the vessels. How does the vessels themselves get injured?
Surgery.
Maybe surgery, varicose veins, what else?
Trauma.
What were you going to say, April?
Getting injury, like got hit.
Exactly. So these are things, these are important things that set the patient up for deep vein thrombosis, which sets the patient up for a pulmonary embolism. Notice that blood clots are not the only thing that embolisms can be made up of. It can be fat, air, amniotic fluid, bone marrow, tumor fragments. There can be a ball of hair and debris. There's lots of different things that can get into and form an obstruction. Anything else in here? Okay. So I wanted to take a look. I'll let you go on break after this. Take a look at box 21-1. These are things that you want to, it's on page 304. These are things that you want to think about when you're treating a patient. Did they have one of these things going on? The inactivity, congestive heart failure. They might have had surgery, pelvic surgery. Trauma, especially the long bones. If someone comes in with a long brain fracture, look for pulmonary embolism. Just look for it. Because it has a very high potential of happening. Contraceptives. Female patients who are on birth control. That's another sign. You have a 32-year-old or a 28-year-old that comes in. They're complaining of shortness of breath. And they may have developed a little bit of a cough. And their PaO2 is low. Wait a minute, this patient could have a pulmonary embolism because of the birth control pills. And then I'm seeing some signs and symptoms that are making me think. Obesity, smoking, burns, and that the burns are going to be associated with the vasculature damage to cause the embolisms to occur. Okay, so go ahead and take a break, and then when you come back, we'll look at a couple of other things, and then look at pulmonary hypertension.
I had a patient the other day that had two pulmonary embolisms at one time. How does that, and he survived it. He has a green filter, I think. I thought once you get a pulmonary embolism, and he said he had it in both lungs, how do you, like, you die right after? Well, more than likely you're going to die if you have a pulmonary embolism.
Well, that's if it's not extracted.
Or
if it's not broken up. So they could have given him a fibrinolytic, broke the emboli up, and now he's okay.
Okay.
So would you want to actually extract it? Is that the safest?
That's not good.
No, is that the most preferred method, or would you just want to break it up?
It depends on how big it is and how much impairment it's causing. And plus, you got to have somebody that can do the surgery.
Yeah. And for breaking it up, would you, for medicine or?
Fibrinolytics.
You wouldn't want to kind of hit on it and try to break it up?
Because that's liable to get it lodged in other places.
Like my mom, she had a blood clot in her leg from the surgery, and they just told her to take aspirin every day, one tablet a day. And that's it. They wouldn't remove it or any of that, which is really confusing why they wouldn't just get rid of it right then and there.
Say that again.
So she had a blood clot in her, and I think her leg from the surgery she got, and they just told her, they put her on warfarin. And then after that, they sent her home and just told her to take aspirin every day. Why wouldn't they just get rid of it since it's already in the leg? And then
it wasn't big enough to be doing any damage at that point, and the aspirin's gonna keep it from getting bigger.
She's still taking warfarin.
I have a question.
She's gonna take aspirin.
I have read that before.
She's really bad at taking.
On my birth control packs, I've looked at it and I've seen the DEBTs. Why is that, do you know?
It's because of what's in the contraceptive increases the increases the ability of the blood to clot.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's one of those double effects. You want the medicine to prevent child
right.
But an effect of that,
yeah.
Especially if you smoke along
right.
with it. So,
if you don't smoke and you have like a pretty basic exercise plan, do you think it would help prevent it or no?
Yeah. It's not, I don't think it's real common, but it is, that should be suspect. Patient presents a certain way, and especially if they're young and a female. Just that should be in the back of your mind. This could be happening. And a lot of times with the small embolisms, they get filtered out in the pulmonary vasculature. They're just not big enough. It's the big ones that get lodged in a vessel.
I know that they say that once you get a blood clot, if you do a lot of exercise, then it can travel up through time. And that was like why my biggest concern was. Because, you know, isn't that a thing? Like, if you do a lot of exercise, you could possibly make it, the blood clot move up into the thoracic.
I would have to research that. I'm not sure about that. I remember one time we had a patient who had suspected emboli, and they ordered a more chest PT, and I called the doctor and just asked and said, I noticed that this patient has possible possible embolism, and that's a relative contraindication for chest PT, but he wanted it done, so we did it. It was okay, nothing happened, but
that would scare me.
But the patient weren't showing any signs and symptoms of, so it's at that point relative contraindication. He did have a lot of secretions and stuff, so get the secretions out and prevent a pneumonia. But the point is to ask and to think about things that are happening or could happen. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but these diseases, there's so much to them, and and so you end up, you know, you remember the most important part of, and then you've got resources that you can go to and look up other stuff. Mm-hmm. So I wish, you know, that I wish I knew so much more about them, but it's, you know, you can only remember so much.
Do you think we need something to be high altitude pulmonary edema? It's just everything in bold I'm reading, so a lot of the questions come from the book. So there are a couple things that weren't.
That doesn't stick out, but realize it could happen.
That's good though, you just really like pay more attention into the whole.
Except for those couple of areas that were not bolded. How the fluid moves.
I did not expect that to